10,000 years ago, there was no corn, just a grass called Teosinte, specifically Zea maize species paraviglumus. This grass looked little like modern corn. The plant is highly branched, the kernels are small, few in number, not fused, and enclosed in a hard fruit case. But somehow, early farmers turned this grass into corn. So how did they do it? When early farmers grew their proto-corn, each year they selected what they considered the best individuals to take seeds from for the next season. With each generation, the plant was enriched for traits that made it more useful to humans. Over time, random genetic mutations that would improve the crop would occur, and these would be bred into corn by this process. And slowly, the plant became closer to the corn we know today. But that's not the whole story. Up to 12% of the genetic material in corn is derived from Zea maize species Mexicana, and these genes are thought to have been introduced through introgressive hybridization. By this process, genes are introduced into one plant from a closely related plant. It begins with the two lines being crossed, producing offspring, where one allele of each gene comes from each parent. Then, by repeatedly backcrossing with one of the parents, we can be left with only a few genes derived from the second parent, effectively introducing these genes into one plant from the other. How intentionally this was done by our ancient Mesoamerican farmers, we will likely never know, but we do know that the end result was a humble grass became the power crop we know today. But how easy was it to change a wild grass into something similar to today's corn? Well, in the 1930s, Nobel Prize-winning scientist George Beadle did an experiment. He crossed the wild grass with a domesticated corn, producing an F1 hybrid containing one copy of each gene from each parent, one from the wild grass and the other from modern corn. He then crossed the F1 hybrid with itself, producing an F2 hybrid, and scored the phenotype of these plants. He was looking for how many of these plants resembled modern corn and wild-type grass, and how many were somewhere in between. If you remember your high school biology and your Punnett squares, you'll know what to expect. For each gene, one quarter of the plants would carry two copies of the allele from corn, and another quarter two copies originally from the wild grass, with the other half of the plants retaining one copy from each. So if one gene was governing the entire phenotypic difference between modern corn and wild Teosinte, we would find one in four plants that look like corn. If two genes are required, only 1 in 16 plants will receive two copies of both genes from corn, and another 1 in 16 will receive two copies of both genes from the wild grass. We can generalize this to 1 in 4 to the power of n, where n is the number of genes involved in the phenotypic differences. Beadle scored about 50,000 F2 plants, and found that 1 in 500 resembled corn, and another 1 in 500 resembled the wild grass, putting the number of genes dictating the phenotypic differences at just 4 or 5. Not too many for our ancient agriculturalists to breed in. Of course, many other genes have refined corn to be the crop it is today, but fundamentally, changing just a few genes can turn a practically inedible grass into a useful crop. How could so few genes have such a large effect? Well, the genes involved are regulatory genes, whose role is to dictate the expression of other genes. In this way, these few genes control the expression of dozens of other genes that ultimately lead to drastic phenotypic changes.
Hey, soliloquy, that answers the question of how they changed the plant, but it leaves the question of why they would even start cultivating Teosinte in the first place.
There is a theory for that too, and the key to this is the hard fruit cases. With heat applied to the Teosinte kernels, water is vaporized inside the kernels, cooking the starch and building up pressure until the hard fruit cases can withstand no more and it bursts, resulting in fluffy white popcorn. Then it's just a matter of growing enough plants to support the cities of the Mesoamerican civilizations.
And that was not as easy as it sounds. The Aztec solution was the chinampa, artificial islands that were created by building up extensions of soil into freshwater lakes. The chinampas were made from layering mud over tree trunks stuck in the lake until you had a legitimate island. With these islands, they could grow enough food for their massive capital of Tenochtitlan. They transported the food from the chinampas back to the city using a series of canals. That's right, Tenochtitlan had canals, just like Venice. The water the city sat on, however, was brackish, or semi-salt water, and not so good for farming with. To fix this problem, the Aztecs built a series of dams to keep out the salt water and control the levels of the lake. The dams even were complete with a system of channels to prevent flooding. You'd actually be surprised by how many technological innovations pre-Columbian indigenous peoples had built. If you go over to my channel, I released a video talking about just a few of these amazing technologies.
Fantastic. I'll grab the popcorn, or the Teosinte kernels, and let's head over to Step Back History and find out what else the Aztecs invented. You'll find links to the video in all the usual places.